It is another edition of the Daily Grossi. Chris Holdak and our Browns analyst Tony Grossi alongside me. All right, Tone, we got a lot to get to today. We will dive through your mock draft 1.0, break it down, see where the Browns pick. But let's start with a little wrinkle in the potential Brazil game here. Now, Rob Domofsky of ESPN NFL Nation, Packers reporter, came out today on Twitter and said, based on a conversation and availability of President Mark Murphy's comments this morning, it sounds like now the Packers are preparing to open the season against the Eagles in Brazil. He said, speaking before the Packers' annual tailgate tour departed, Murphy, team president, said, we're either first or second most popular team in Brazil, and that he added, we're expecting an announcement any day, and also that this is a very important for the league. If we're chosen, we'll gladly go. What do you make of this latest twist in the Brazil saga?
Yeah, first of all, it would be a relief to me personally if they chose the Packers. I don't know if the Browns would consider it that way or not. Second of all, you mentioned the twist in the story. It seems to me that there's been some twisting of arms by the NFL to get the Green Bay Packers and the Philadelphia Eagles to move this Green Bay game from Philadelphia to Brazil. Just a week and a half ago, it appeared that the Packers were adamant in not wanting to go. But Mark Murphy, after those prepared remarks, I guess, was interviewed and talked about how they're enthusiastic now about going. And apparently the Eagles, we haven't heard anything from the Eagles, but everyone I talked to at the owners' meeting, the Eagles preferred to keep that Green Bay game in Philadelphia rather than move it to a neutral site. It's an important game for both of those teams, and right, it really levels the playing field for the Packers. So anyway, my gut reaction is that the NFL has talked both teams into approving this matchup as the best for the league, and nothing official yet. Even Mark Murphy said, not official, but they are expecting to hear soon, which to me means the Packers probably informed them, yeah, okay, we'll go.
Yeah.
And we'll right, probably get an announcement by the end of the week and put an end to the story already, right, Chris.
I hear you. All right. So now what does that mean for the Browns in terms of international games? They do have Jacksonville on their road schedule. As of right now, it would be a game in Jacksonville. Any chance that could be a London game?
Yeah. So I think Jacksonville's playing two games again in London, and I think one of them has been announced, their opponent. I think that's true. So there is still another game for Jacksonville to pair up with. And as you mentioned, the Browns are on the road schedule. The reason I would say not likely or less than 50% that the Browns would be chosen to go to London is because next year, of course, AFC teams have the extra home game, 9 games at home next year. And, you know, the Browns have yet to relinquish a home game for an international game. That when they went in 2017, they were the road game to Minnesota. And there is a rule on the books that every team must give up a home game over the next 10 years. And this was put into place about 2 or 3 years ago. So that's why I would hesitate and not jump into that conclusion just yet, because if the Browns are not assigned to London this year, I would bet money on your favorite app that they go next year as a home team. So we'll see. Hopefully they'll announce all these international matchups and get it over with already. Again, though, I'm relieved if it's not the Browns going to Sao Paulo.
Yeah. Now, just so everybody has it on the radar, because we've thrown around international dates, and the actual schedule release is in May, correct? Is it
correct,
late May or early May?
I think it's mid-May.
Okay.
But they usually, prior to that, they will have all the matchups internationally announced, just not the day and the time.
Okay, but the matchups themselves.
We know the Brazil game is Friday night. That's part of the hype for that game. But I would expect all international games to be announced prior to the May schedule release.
Gotcha. All right, Tone, let's take a look at mock draft 1.0. Now, you actually did this back on Friday, but we have not yet on the Daily Grossi have had a chance to do this. So let's start right at the top. You have quarterbacks going one, Caleb Williams out of USC to Chicago. Number two, Jaden Daniels going to Washington. Drake May going to New England. So the top three are quarterbacks. And no real surprise there in terms of, I mean, this has been the talk since the season ended that quarterbacks will go heavy and quickly in the first round.
I also think that order is right on and might not change. You know, Williams, no matter who is making the picks, Williams, Daniels, and May, and J.J. McCarthy could be fourth. However, one thing I'll say, Chris, and I mentioned this in my mock draft story, I expect one or two teams to both trade into the top five, starting with New England at three. I think 3, 4, 5, New England, Arizona, and the Chargers are prime candidates to move down for teams like Minnesota and Denver to move up for quarterbacks. I don't think it's going to change the top three order. But then McCarthy will go fourth if Minnesota or even Denver's able to move up.
Yeah. Now you do have, since you mentioned them, if we in your draft, again, you didn't take into account trades. You have Minnesota taking J.J. McCarthy out of Michigan, Denver at 12, taking Bo Nix, the quarterback, out of Oregon. And all the way down at 16, the sixth quarterback, if I'm doing my math correct here, in the first round, Michael Penix Jr., the QB out of Washington, going to Seattle. Tony, can you remember of a time, if ever, I don't know if it's happened, six quarterbacks in the top 16? Let alone in the first round?
No, I know there were five quarterbacks in 1983 in the first round. And I think another year there were five in the first round. But not that high, all five of them, or not six of them. Now, the thing about Penix, most of the reputable draft evaluators have Penix rated as a second or high third round pick. I think he'll go in the first round just because of the desperation for teams, because there's a big, you know, look, if you're Denver, just consider Denver. They don't have a second round pick, so they can't wait for the second round.
Right.
And they need a quarterback badly. Same thing. Minnesota has two number ones. I'm not sure if they have a two or not, but they're not going to wait. They're not going to gamble for the second round. That's why these quarterbacks will get overdrafted. But I want to say this about Penix. I love Penix. I would take him if I were in that vicinity and needing a quarterback. So we'll see how he turns out. But I really like Penix, not as the best quarterback, but as a guy who's going to be successful.
Yeah. All right, Tone, let's take a look at the division now in your mock draft 1.0 here. The first division team slated is the Cincinnati Bengals at 18, and you have them taking a really good wide receiver out of LSU, Brian Thomas, just what Joe Burrow needs, another LSU guy to throw the ball to.
Yeah, and he, in my mock, would be the fourth receiver after, of course, the big three, Marvin Harrison, Roma Dunsey, and Malik Nabers. The teammate of his at LSU, and Thomas had 17 touchdowns, I think, led the nation. It's possible Thomas won't last that long, and even if he doesn't, I think Cincinnati is taking a receiver. They're so good at it. They always hit bullseyes no matter where they take a receiver. And the plan there is for T. Higgins to play this last year on the franchise tag. Then they'll let him go and replace him with Brian Thomas or whomever. And then they'll worry about getting Ja'Marr Chase under a new contract. They need a stud, just like I say about the Browns. They need their next stud receiver to be on a rookie contract because they already have Burrow, of course, in a $100 million, $200 million. So, Cincinnati, I think, takes receiver.
At 20, you have the Steelers taking an offensive player, getting help for Russell Wilson. Not a skill guy, an offensive lineman, the OT, J.C. Latham out of Alabama. And, Tony, the Steelers are good when they are good in the trenches.
They took an offensive tackle last year, Broderick Jones of Georgia, end up being a, he's entrenched as the right tackle now. This is a good year for offensive tackles. I mean, you don't have to be in the top five to get them. There's going to be four, five, six of them in the first round. In Pittsburgh, they're thinking Broderick Jones's teammate from Georgia, Amarius Mims, who I have going, I think, 25th later in the round. J.C. Latham is a little bit higher rated, so that's why I pegged him there. I do think that they don't move on. It's offensive tackle for the Steelers.
Another team taking an offensive tackle, Baltimore at 30. Tyler Guyton, the offensive tackle out of Oklahoma.
Yeah, he, in my mock, is just the next best available tackle. I think that's where they're going. You know, they have to replace three starters on their offensive line. One is a tackle and two guards. So I think they go that way. They could go guard there, but, and we'll see. My final mock, which will be 2.0, I'm only doing two of them. You won't shame me into any more than that.
I'm going to try.
I have my official prediction in that one. But early on, I see them taking the best available offensive tackle there at 30.
You do have the Steelers at 51 as we now make our way into the second round. You have the Steelers taking Malachi Corley, smaller but quicker wide receiver out of Western Kentucky. And Tony, this is another team I feel like when they draft wide receivers, they rarely miss.
You're right. And some mocks that I've seen have Corley destined to the Browns at 54. I am off of that because Corley's more of a, from what everything I've read and studied, is more of a slot receiver who can be very effective. And I don't think the Browns are looking for that. So that's why I mocked Corley there. I think Pittsburgh, wants to give George Pickens some help. They traded Deontay Johnson. They're really their number one A wide out. So I do see them taking a receiver in the first two rounds.
At 54 in the 2024 NFL draft, the Cleveland Browns select wide receiver Troy Franklin out of Oregon. Why do you have him slotted here? Why do you think he'd be a good fit?
He's got speed. They want speed. They don't want a possession guy. They don't want a slot guy or a little guy too. He's got size. He's kind of thin, so like 6'1.5" and 180 pounds, something like that. But had a good combine, ran a 4.4 40. Very productive at Oregon with Bo Nix throwing him the ball. I do think there's a slot open to draft a quarterback, even after the Jerry Jeudy trade. And I think there's a slot for someone who's like fourth best on the totem pole right now. That's either Cedric Tillman or David Bell. I think the Browns will use a lot of receivers and they need backups at those positions too. So there, I think there's an extra roster spot available for a seventh wideout this year with a possibly James Prochet being seventh, Bell and Tillman being fifth or sixth. And then that number four spots, I would think Troy Franklin would be better than Bell and Tillman as right off the bat. So that's what I got right now. I also think he's possibility he won't even be there. He's a pretty highly rated wideout. But as I've said a lot on our podcast, you're going to get a pretty good wideout at 54. And in this draft, he's the guy for me.
If not wide receiver, what position do you imagine the Browns would take at 54?
You know, there was news today of the number two tight end. I forgot his name, Jatavius Huntley or something like that, visiting the Browns. Tight end at 54, I kind of doubt it, but tight end is the position I think might be drafted over the five rounds. linebacker. Now, there are a couple, the best off-ball linebackers are going to be right in this vicinity. In my mock, they're both gone. So if one of them was still there, would the Browns take him? It depends if he's got a better grade than the wideouts we're talking about. So I think off-ball linebacker could be a possibility, you know, a JOK type draft where they traded up for him actually in the second round. I don't think defensive tackle at this position. I've seen some people mock the Browns for defensive tackle and also the running back. I don't think that either. I know they supposedly are visiting with Trey Benson, the pretty good running back. Trey Benson is, Chris, I see him as a number one running back for a team that needs a running back.
Yeah.
And I don't put the Browns in that category. Maybe I'm in the minority. We'll see. But those are the other positions I would consider at 54. But I still think it's pretty strong in my mind to be receiver.
Yeah. Well, Tone, the draft is just 2 weeks away from this Thursday. If I do my math correctly, that means this week is mock draft 2.0, 3.0. We could get to mock draft 4.0.
No, Chris, I'm telling you, you guys shamed me into doing this. It took me 3.5 hours to make sure. In the past, I've done mock drafts where I've had the same guy drafted twice. I've had like a top 10 guy not even drafted. I mean, it gets really tedious to keep track of everything, and I'm going to take my time, and there's going to be trades. I think there will be trades in the first round before the draft, so I want that to settle down, and I'll have my official final mock 2.0 on April 25th, maybe the night of April 24th for our subscribers.
Fair enough. Tone, great stuff as always. Appreciate it. We'll catch up again tomorrow.
All right, Chris. Thank you. See you then.